do think the neighbourhood agenda, which is obviously part of Healthy World, is an area that we should be rightly proud of, and lots of people have put a lot of work into. Because I know, in comparison to some of others in Cheshire and Merseyside, we are ahead. Now, as Graham's alluded to, the NHS long-term plans kind of caught up with it being a good idea to work in this way. So that we are going through a phase at the moment of allowing practices to work out how primary care networks can be formed, and then there'll be, as Graham said, a period where we need to see how neighbourhoods work with the primary care networks. But there is a lot of work currently happening, and that will not stop. But I just want to point out, we are ahead of the game, and we should be proud of the work happening for Wirral, because this is about people and communities rather than about organisations. Comments, questions?
Thanks, Sue. And I just wanted to add to what you've said. It is, we are ahead of the curve here, and we are now starting to see lots of changes starting to happen. It has been a slow process, and it's been sometimes challenging to get everybody in the room to agree that this is the thing to do. And primary care networks has been something that we'll just need to work our way through and keep the. I think if we keep people at the centre of what we're doing and that difference, then we won't go wrong. And there's lots of anecdotes now that we hear about people. And I think one of the things is that from those personal independent coordinators, one of them was talking up there, is the initial things that, oh, they've reduced people going to their GPs. But what we're also now discovering, as the time's going on, there's always a bit of a backlog with us seeing the actual changing activity at the hospital, is that that's also stopping people going into hospital, non-elective, we call it, which is actually, it's the worst way to go into hospital because it's unplanned. And yes, sometimes you do have to go in and it's not planned, but if we can do anything to reduce that in the most frail elderly population, then you know, I think that we are definitely on the right track. So I think the focus has to be on making that difference to people, not patients, but to people as a whole.
I think there's been a little bit of concern over recent weeks that the announcement about the PCNs from HSMs might sort of undo some of the really good work that's gone on, but I don't think that's the case at all. I think that being, as you said, being ahead of the game, actually this is some really good building blocks. I think it's very likely that those neighbourhoods will change and expect in terms of the way they're organised at the moment, but that doesn't mean that all the stuff that underlies that, and actually it's partly about changing the mindset of primary care, but also social care and the other services who are involved in those teams coming together. I think that bit of work, which is really hard, changing people's mindsets is difficult work. And that's really got underway, and I don't think the fact that some practices might be run with other practices than they are now really matters, actually, because I think the building blocks are there, and that's what really matters.
Any other questions or comments? Yeah, come.
Thank you, Chair. I think there's a real opportunity for children, where we are in our improvement journey also. Many colleagues on there, we centralise our children's social care for the reasons of improvements and standardised practice and really on the outcomes of children. But that's a short-term measure to bring everyone together and actually in part of the at the beginning, then we can begin to look at those nine neighbourhoods and how we then disaggregate a centralised model back into the neighbourhood and localised model rather than being an individual separate framework for locality work. So we welcome them. Yeah, just a final comment really, I just think it really fits into the personal story that we've had, and I would believe that had this gentleman gone much earlier, he would be getting the primary care that we can offer here. So it's just really good thing for him. Thank you.
It obviously is part of a national programme now, but I mean, if we think back to Wirral, and I was interested in thinking about this table is in the shape of Wirral, isn't it? So we know very clearly the huge difference in demographics in a small area that we serve. Mm-hmm. So it absolutely makes sense that, the requirements for different areas need to be looked at in a slightly different fashion. So thank you for all those involved in the work.
Just sort of for your information, I work very closely with the Senior Learning. I will be at the next meetings, not through choice, but I will be at the next meetings. But that's what I'm going off to do. I'll be working with AG Play on these teams and on another project, which is Reminder Finds, which is helping people with early onset dementia, but also caring for their carers. Because I think one of the things that we forget, not just here on the road, but everywhere, is the fabulous job that carers do. And I don't know if anybody's ever done any sort of evaluation on what they actually save monetary wise as well as emotionally wise. So that's what I'm going on to do. So I will be sitting around the table meeting because I go to more than neighbourhood meetings. So I will be around, but that's what I'm going on to do. So I'm going on to do something really worthwhile and something that I really enjoy as well. So just for that.
Thanks, Bernie. Good to hear. Any further comments on that? Well, thank you very much, and I'm sure you'll carry on bringing us updates because, as you've just shown from slides, the date of March is a moving field. Simon, Chief Officer's Report.
So, just starting Chief Officer's Report with a bit of an explanation about the dates and background information. So, the Chief Officer's Reports have been taken to the governing body of Wirral CCG for the last couple of years, and it's my practice where I'm in such a role to bring reports to update the respective government body. So this was due also to go to a government body on the 9th of April, hence it goes a little bit beyond today, but also it was written on the 4th of March, so some things have not happened as originally anticipated within the report. It also means I have to give a little bit more of a verbal update on some of the items I've written about. So starting with the monthly Clinical Commissioning Group Chief Officers meetings, this is a means where NHS England and my fellow Chief Officers of Clinical Commissioning Groups can come together, and it's effectively an opportunity for a bit of State of the Nation discussions. The meeting on the 12th of March was an unusual meeting in that we were welcoming Bill McCarthy, who started on Monday of this week as the new North West Regional Director for the merged NHS England and NHS Improvement regulatory bodies. Bill's an economist by training, has worked in academia, but also has worked in various roles in health and care over the last few years. Bill was clear that the four big things that need to be focused upon, firstly planning and delivery. He said boring but absolutely essential. We have to make sure that we are doing things like we are doing when we're all around the 5-year system plan. We have to secondly ensure that we create sustainability through integration in local places. So again, we've just had some stories about how Wirral we've integrated, and making sure that the places connect with emerging primary care networks, which again he emphasised service delivery vehicles. They're not new organisations, they're a means of delivering service more effectively to local populations. We also need to ensure, thirdly, that there's collaboration at all levels, so there's collaboration between those delivering services locally and those delivering services at more of a specialist end. And finally, we need to develop as a system an approach around creating and sustaining the workforce of today, but creating the workforce of tomorrow. The other things covered, all areas I think of Cheshire and Merseyside, all places are working on their version of what Healthy Wirral is and developing local networks. We had a presentation about the creation of one clinical commissioning group for Cheshire that covers two areas of Chester and Cheshire West Council, and also East Cheshire Council. They are places in their own right that will have one clinical commissioning group doing the health commissioning over them. One of the interesting parts of their presentation was how within their local neighbourhoods or their equivalent neighbourhoods, they've aligned themselves so that the people locally understand who their local elected members are. are, with their police, their PCSOs, police constable support officers, and things like that, police community support officers. So actually, they're really thinking about how they not only align their health and care elements of neighbours, but also the other factors that we've been talking about earlier, which are very, very important. And they affect the key determinants of health about being safe and well. And similarly, in St Helens, they have the St Helens Cares programme, whereby they've also gone on a joint commissioning journey with the local authority, bringing together health and care. They, however, also have economic ambassadors aligned to each of their neighbourhoods. So I think there's a real role here through the Wirral Partnership about discussions with the Chamber of Commerce and about bringing local business into those discussions as well. So I brought back those slides and shared with Graham, Nesta and others. So as we develop this approach, we keep that in mind. Other items covered, collaborative commission forum, which I'll come on to later, and mental health programme board as well. But in terms of planning and five-year strategies, as stated earlier in the Healthy Wirral report, all systems are working on that. And some of the key principles, what they want to see going forward, is again working as systems rather than as individual organisations. Making sure that over the next year we reduce the number of people waiting for planned and elective care. So seeing, as we've done on Wirral, eradicating 52 people waiting more than 52 weeks for elective operations and reducing the overall numbers waiting as a whole. Refining our plans around non-elective and unplanned care, so actually we admit fewer people into hospitals, we're also reduce the number of people attending. Again, we've heard earlier, our frailty programme is starting to make some impact around that. Ensuring as we move forward that all organisations have aligned financial plans around addressing system gaps and deficits. And we'll be supported in doing that finally by the coming together of NHS England and NHS Improvement as regulators of the health part of our system. And they will continue to work closely together. And emphasising this isn't just about hospitals, this is about mental health services, community services, learning disability services, and primary care as well. Continuing on the bottom of page 63, I think I've covered about in the Healthy Wirral report about the work we've done on operational planning. Over the page, on page 64, the items that I was due to attend prior to the writing of this report have all been successfully completed. The screening committee on the 19th of March focused on three key items for us, I suppose, phlebotomy. So we have an issue with 22 of our 51 practices in the provision of phlebotomy services. 29 of the practices are delivering phlebotomy services with very little public concern, but we have had some challenges in the other 22. Originally, the Community Trust were called to present on this item. I was subsequently asked to join them at the table as it emerged that actually the Community Trust shouldn't have been the people under scrutiny, which is probably the 22 practices. So we're now working those 22 practices, and I think within the next few weeks we'll have some plans from them about how they're going to resolve that issue of phlebotomy services. One of the other really, I think, exciting pieces of screening was around the work that Simon Garner, who works for us, has been doing on extra care housing and bringing in about 380 additional units over the next couple of years into the Wirral system, which will keep people in a home-like environment for longer with care wrapped around them, which again reduces the likelihood of them ending up in a hospital setting in an unintended way with quite substantial and difficult consequences in many cases. So some very, very good work been going on there with Simon leading that. And finally, Lorna presented on a scrutiny review that was done some time ago around continuing healthcare. And there's concerns over how the packages of care were being assessed, how we managed, how people were being placed, And I'm pleased to report that all the items identified for improvement, Lorna and the team addressed in the action plan and in the response. The Health and Wellbeing Board on the 20th of March is also referenced on page 65 of the report, and thanks to John Brace, who highlighted, actually, I've said in the report, the proceedings can be viewed. The Health and Wellbeing Board wasn't filmed like we are today. However, John did film it, and I think it's available on your website. The proceedings of the Health and Wellbeing Board on the 20th of March, should people wish to view them. But at that meeting, we gave an update on the NHS long-term plan, an update on Healthy Wirral, which we've received today. There was a call to action from colleagues from Public Health on the health protection agenda around antimicrobial resistance, tackling alcohol harm, and other items. Graham gave an update, as you've seen today, on Neighbourhoods and the Joint Strategic Commissioning Board, and also the Chair of the Adult Safeguarding Board came along to present on their work. In terms of Healthy Wirral, the timeout for Wirral Health and Care Commissioning staff that I mentioned earlier, the first one will be a week today, on the 9th of April, and that will be a rolling programme, one in May and one in June to finish the job off. Continuing on page 64, the board to board on the 27th of March with Wirral Hospitals went extremely well. I think we have identified items that we need to progress upon within the Healthy Wirral plan where it was absolutely mutual benefit and benefit for the wider system. I think those items would be developing work around outpatient redesign, as I mentioned earlier, improving non-elective care by improving the flow of people through the hospital, and also working on medicines optimisation, which is are we using medicines effectively? Are we switching people to medicines that actually are just as effective for them, also cheaper for the system? And are those people working as a system? So are we making sure community pharmacists, hospital pharmacists, clinical pharmacists working in practices are working alongside each other and supporting the development of the neighbourhoods? Page 64 again, 3.1.5 actually spoke to a guy called Jody Hebovitz rather than Neil McEnroy around the economic impact of health and care. I'm speaking at an event tomorrow on the topic of the health and economic impact, and actually the NHS as an anchor institution and the role that we can play in improving environment, improving housing, improving employment, and actually how we are working together on what are around things like social value and other things. Bottom of page 64, the collaborative commission forum, I think there was four key things within that. We received a paper on the development of stroke services across Cheshire and Merseyside, and essentially the need to have really good rehabilitation and early supported discharge services locally. So that features very heavily in the Wirral plan for next year. We also had a presentation from Judy Webster on prevention as a prevention on alcohol harm, which again has been adopted in our local plans. We also agreed as CCGs collectively to support the a surgical service at St Helens and Mosley Hospitals, which provides something called deep inferior epigastric perforator flap, or DEP surgery, which is a more effective and less invasive way of dealing with breast replacement post cancer surgery. So this is where women have actually had their breasts removed, and this is a means by which breast reconstruction can take place in a manner that is actually more effective. We want to just establish that service as one that we would wish to use going forward. And as we've done that, we will want to look at the pathways for rural women into that service as well to maximise our usage. So they were the main items from the Collaborative Commission Forum. Finally on page 65, We, the complete commissioning part of Rural Health and Care Commissioning is accountable to NHS England, ultimately to the Secretary of State through NHS England. And we have been given notice that on the 10th of May we will have our annual improvement and assessment framework meeting with NHS England, where we'll be focusing upon the work we've done around health and Wirral, our financial recovery, and how we operate within the system. Also under 3.3.2, unfortunately the meeting with Frank Field MP has been postponed. We're setting a future date for that, largely because I think other things have been happening in Westminster that I think our local members of Parliament have had to be engaged in. The meeting with Alison McGovern was really, really fruitful, and the office, Alison's office, rang ahead to say these are the things we want to speak to you about, which meant we were able to get an expert in a room rather than me. Around mental health services. So Joe Watts, our Mental Health Commissioning Manager, sat in on that meeting and is arranging for Alison to spend some time with some of the mental health services in the borough and do some shadowing. And then finally, in terms of being accessible and accountable to local communities, we have the public question time tomorrow night at Bevington Civic Hall. Between 6:30 and 8, which is open to all members of the public. We usually run those questions bit 6:30 to 7:30, and then we stay around afterwards to pick up any personal issues that people might have. So I think that I've covered all the items in the report, plus the items that are in the report that need a bit of elaboration.
Thank you, Simon. Anyone got any? Yes, Stuart.
Thanks, Sam, for your comprehensive reports. I just want to touch on what you mentioned, the importance of extreme health and housing. I think it's important to know that Narrowband is actually Minister of State of Health and Housing.
Yeah.
So even at this age, there was a recognition of the link between their couples and housing and their
people's
health.
Thanks, Stuart. Absolutely right. And in fact, I was thinking of whilst we were discussing the neighbourhoods, I know there's some potential regeneration work being discussed on. I think the neighbourhoods that affects, that's going to be really important for it's absolutely where somebody lives has a significant effect on health and well-being. Any other comments? Thank you. So the next item is children's safeguarding arrangements. Lorna, you're leading on that tonight, but I don't know well want to chip in.
Thank you, Chair. Can I ask members to go to page 104, 105 of your pack? I will be displaying the presentation as well. Apologies that your pack is quite weighty, but we have put in more detail there should you require it. So what I want to take members through today is to give assurance regarding new safeguarding arrangements that we will be having in place from the 1st of April of this year, but statutorily what needs to be in place by September of this year. This is because the Children's Social Work Act back in 2017 has replaced local safeguarding boards with new local safeguarding arrangements, and the changes are that it needs to now be led by three statutory safeguarding partners, which is local authorities, so it's all voices or Director of Children's Services. Merseyside Police, which is the area commander, which currently is Ian Hassel, and also CCG, which is myself. So we are the three statutory partners who've been undertaking this work and have shown today where we're up to with it and what we've completed. It also places a duty on child death review partners as well to review the deaths of children normally resident in the local area. Now that doesn't really replace, we already have a process which people know as CDOP or the Children Death Overview House, so we will be maintaining that. But it's just the responsibility now falls on two partners, which is ourselves and the local authority. So in the Act it says that the three safeguarding partners must set out how they will work together, and that's what we've done, and that's what Paul, myself and Ian have been doing over the past numerous months out, we've gone up to consultation, we've had two scrutiny committees to test this, and so here we are today with it. So what we actually did when we started this is we wanted to have three central parts of the model, and we actually started at the bottom and worked our way up. So we started looking at around what practice and what good looks like. So rather than doing governance and what we've currently got and then let's shape around what we've got, we actually moved it the other way and say, what does good look like? What does good practice look like? And then let's move it up. So we really examined the model of delivery that we've got, which is around supporting families and enhancing futures. We also talked around as well practice around how we want to work as a board together, and particularly our behaviours and our standards that we wanted to set as a board. From that, we then looked at the services that we have and around our partnership around policies and strategy, or workforce developments, or child tech review will be done on a local city region, because again, we want to be looking at we can share the learnings across. Or 175 or some of our approaches to case reviews will also be done on a regional approach. So we'll have a local arrangement, but we'll certainly have regional things to it where we need to participate. The next slide really is just sort of a pictorial overview of the model. And then just finally, it just gives you more explanation on what the key features are. So we will have an executive group, which will have the three statutory partners together, working together there. We will have a partnership group, which will be drawn from a number of stakeholders and relevant agencies, which will include lay members again to give us that scrutiny, and also as well we'll be looking for younger people. So again, that's going to be happening twice a year. As I mentioned earlier, our independent scrutiny will remain in place until we've tested this model fully. We've got four business intelligence and quality assurance units involved in it as well. We will have some child-specific groups around safeguarding, and we will be using Pamela's design as well. And then just finally, the dates of which we are on timeline and where we're at. So we are absolutely up to date. We've had this approved now by Cabinet. We've had our overview scrutiny spotlight sessions. We've undertaken consultation. We've now published our model. We're ready to start from this month, our first meeting. In August, the safeguarding board stands down after we've tested this model, and a new statutory arrangement will be in place in September. I'm happy to take any comments or questions from colleagues.
Thanks, Laura. That's really useful. Yeah.
Just not one kind of chair, really, support.
Some kind of support at Laura's presentation. I think it's a really timely point for Wirral. We're coming up to 3 years since for the re-inspection of Wirral Service and the local authorities are at really this cusp, really. And it's not all about Ofsted. Ofsted is will give us the judgment, hopefully, which will be quite improving and adequate. But we, to govern ourselves and our improvement, we also have an improvement board that's been in operation, sort of hand in hand with the safeguarding board. Actually, after the inspection comes summer, that improvement subject to DfE intervention will stand down. So it's important that as a mechanism to continue with the work and sustainability of the improvement journey, because as I say, if we stop on sectors being open, we haven't done our job over the past 3 years. And I think it's real testimony to Wirral that they've obtained this mechanism, albeit both it requires improvement and continued improvement to make sure that we really improve those outcomes to our children.
Anyone else comments or questions? Well, thank you for that, Laura, because obviously, you know, updates is about a huge piece of very important work. Thank you for that. So, date and time of the next meeting, there was just a minor error in the paper that went out that stated that July was the next meeting. That's not correct. There is a meeting on the 28th of May, so hopefully you have that in the diaries. I have no urgent business. I just wanted to take this opportunity. I think it's now a year that we've been sitting formally in this group, although there obviously was a developmental period before that. I just want to thank everybody for their input into the, you know, the work we've done in this, which we had some illustration of the importance of it earlier on. I'm sorry for the bonus I had to get, because he was somebody I particularly wanted to thank, but this is a journey, and I think we've made significant strides in the first year, so let's continue work. Thank you. So, next meeting, 28th of May. Thank you very much.